What was the goal of this trip? What was the meaning of this marvelous journey? I don't even know if all of this was part of a dream or my real life. Do I actually care? I don't think so. Things should keep going on forever and ever again, as locked on an infinite loop of meaningless consistency, trapped in a fog of dark matter. I am the husband of the jazz woman singer, always around and never really there. She had a job to do, she had to perform, this was her business. I had to respect that. I don't try to interfere with her passion. I've never been really fond of jazz music. Of course, her voice is wonderful and she sings with talented musicians. I always share these important moments for my wife. I was the first to clap my hands in the audience and to shout louder than everyone else at the end of each song. I don't think that you can even imagine the loneliness of the husband of the jazz woman singer when she's on the stage. I could feel all her charisma and sex appeal. You think it's easy to enjoy songs when the desire of dozens of men is distinguishable in their pervert looks and discussions, so close that you can even breathe all this perversion in the air? Of course, you would tell me, after 10 years of marriage, I could have made an effort and learned how to play correctly one of those incredible jazz instruments. I wouldn't even be able to learn how to play triangle properly. This is simply too concrete for me. And the visible concreteness we are surrounded by is what I hate the most. My stuff is definitely abstraction, algorithm and math. The place to be for a guy like me was the bar. But even the bartender was not interested by the crappy theories I had always in my mind to escape the reality, to fly this place full of the concrete shame of my infinite ignorance. The double whiskey was my best friend, 3 or 4 glasses per night. Alright dudes, you can laugh at me behind my dark glasses. You can imagine whatever pervert dreams in the arms of my delightful wife. But you will never understand a shit about why I come here and how wonderful are the territories I explore while you are simply contemplating the basic truth, fantasizing on my woman. I'm a consultant for several companies and involved in their programs of research and development. Some of my abstraction skills made me a reputation, particularly in basic research and theorization of phenomena, large spectrum of processes. One of the most powerful tools I use in my job is analogy. Some scientists would say that analogy is the opposite of science. That's a simple way to think, and by the way, a wrong way to think properly. They are just extremists. They will never admit that science remains a belief, like any other beliefs. Science cannot express some kind of absolute truth, as they often argue, simply because hypotheses that are reproducible, even if they are strong enough to give birth to useful technologies, remain restricted in a field of application, relying on paradigms and axiomatic. hypotheses, even very useful, are beliefs in their restricted field of application. Most of the time, this field is enlarged or subdivided by new empirical experiments or discoveries that bring counterexamples or kind of exceptions that makes all the base supporting them collapse, or it revealed as a subdivision of a bigger base. Science remains a belief and expresses relative truths. But these formatted scientists, defending their sanctuaries as warlike priests, are right somehow. Analogy is not part of science. Experiments and analytical reasoning are the best ways to make science grow bigger and bigger every day. But never forget that most of the revolutions of science have been revealed by fools with crazy analogies in their mind, obsessed by them till the moment they could link their intuitions to the monstrous beast. In the world history, lots of us were belonging to the group of those wacky explorers. A few of us succeeded to link their worries to scientific demonstrations and were applauded as geniuses. Most of us died, killed by our own obsessions and abandoned by our peers. Every Friday night at 7:30 p.m. there were dance lessons for people fond of swing. Experienced teachers used to show them the basics and the advanced steps. After 9:35 p.m., most of the dancers stayed to practice on the dance floor, during the jazz concerts, and of course to enjoy the music and have fun too. An evident synergy appeared between the musical programming and the dance lessons. Often big bands were the guests of the day, but most of the time occasionally jazz bands used to perform standards, evergreens and New Orleans classics as an invitation for people to dance. The more dancers had fun, the more people in the restaurant were amazed by the global show resulting of the collaboration of everyone. The more experienced dancers were attracted by the place and the more couples were subscribing to both dance lessons and the jazz club. What a joy to have a whole laboratory for me, a whole small universe to study and to theorize. Such a wonderful place to analyze and catch behaviors, biological and environmental components to feed my hunger of analogies. The neuroscience definitely admits that the human brain is a natural simulator of reality. And I'm quite sure that we could all of us use it as a simulator of abstraction if we were educated this way. But it's not the case. Our education relies on mnemonic tricks mainly. We are enslaved to serve optimally the society, so that's why enhancing our skills of abstraction when we are young is useless. Indoctrinated as the soldiers of the society, we are ready to produce and to make it with money. No need for dreamers, no need for open-minded engineers. They would even disturb us in the war for efficiency we are involved in. Dreamers are a luxury we cannot afford. We don't give a shit to teach the tools of abstraction to the mass. Who the hell care about those nerds' theories of the information, the strings, or the M-theory? Who the hell care if we can unify all the forces of the known universe? If we are surrounded by particles, fermions, dialoguing together by the exchange of bosons? Or if all of it is made of strings swinging, spinning, rotating and bouncing in a world of 11 dimensions? When I was a child, I was a very bad pupil at school. The teachers used to give us mathematic exercise. I was simply not able to prove. Even if I had the answers, and I never was wrong, I was unable to explain the mechanism in my thinking that were revealing step by step the results. A question was asked, and I had strange but familiar shapes appearing in my head. But even if I was unable to describe them with the tool the teachers wanted me to use, the solutions were there, instantly, like mental aurora borealis, whispering the good answers. For a while, I was considered like a cheater, and often punished, till the moment the problem started to be more complex, the same as the analogic ways appearing instantly in my mind to solve them. All began to be clearer as I replaced parameters of the problems by particles. The solutions of the exercises were the particles resulting of the collision of the initial parameters. Then I started to build mentally kind of basic algorithm combining the particles. The atoms and molecules became very useful operators simple functions or variables that I was able to structure together to build even bigger and bigger problematics and hypotheses, kind of libraries of source codes kept somewhere in my unusual memory, ready to be used. I need to fly away from here. I cannot stand anymore. All those persons around me. Keep cool. Let's breathe. Stay calm. Let's breathe quietly, slower and slower. But I can't. I feel like unstable. I need to leave this place. Escape the further I can. Before the concreteness surrounding me absorbs all the abstraction I represent. Before to be trapped forever. Far, far away from here, further, the furthest, fighting the gravity of the conglomeration of all these hypotheses based on nothing but on paradigms and their axiomatics. Keep cool, stay calm. You are just again living one of those awful abstraction overdoses. Keep cool. Stay calm. Let's breathe. There are more life forms than we think around us. We often believe that only entities based on organic chemistry deserve this title. According to me, everything that burns and dies, everything that remains surviving by instinct, reproduction, or even by spontaneous resurrection, deserves to be named a life form. When I am in the jazz club, I can't help thinking about this trapezium and the dance floor. Dancers, as couples, become the two nucleus of a single cell. More and more cells are invading the dance floor. There is probably a law linked to the music I have not found yet that explains the number of cells changing. Shapes appear between the moving cells. These holes seem gathering into a single trapezium when the whole dance floor is occupied by cells. The multicellular life form has reached its ultimate phase. no other cell will be allowed to enter in the organism bounded by the dense floor borders, or it would be rejected. The trapezium and the organisms are condemned to coexist or die together. If I consider the trapezium whole and the cells as multi-agents in assimilation, all of them are interacting and their movements are ruled by basic laws of flocking and steering inside the dense floor. The two nucleus inside of the cells are linked by a string, swinging, spinning, rotating and bouncing in all directions. The difference between rock and swing dance seems to be the autonomy of the female dancer that is not launched and propelled by the male in the second case. There is some kind of fair equality between the male and the female swinger. The male open gates with its arms. The female then decides when she wants to go through them and how far she wants to throw herself. I have never seen a collision, and I think what seems to be a global random choreography is ruled by this moving trapezium. Only female in front of the small base of the trapezium decide to throw themselves inside the trapezium, which is kind of a safety area, avoiding collisions. Remember why you are here. Try to find the exit. Try to survive the monstrous mutating beast remaining in the darkness and always waiting for the good moment to jump and stab you to death. Let's breathe. Let's breathe slowly. Calm down. Calm down. Calm down. Keep cool. Stay calm. You are just again living one of those awful abstraction overdoses. Keep cool. Stay calm. Let's breathe. Years ago, I enjoyed listening to the preachers of those evangelist churches for hours. I was not interested at all by the content of their delirious sermons, but they used lots of metaphors that fed my hunger of analogies for a while. It was incredible how crazy were the objects their imagination was able to compare in some kind of poetic vision of life. These concepts had nothing in common. But parables were so clear and simple that their inner strength was beautiful. Mainly natural phenomena were transposed to human behaviors to give birth to moralizing conclusions supposed to convince the audience. I was there between the members of the flock, but not sharing at all their beliefs. I had algorithms, functions and hypotheses in my mind, and they were stuck like notes to the images the preachers were using. And sometimes their conclusions were perfect, as a result from my scientific worries that had no link at all with the purposes of the preachers. Often they surprised me, but it happened that the priests turned boring after a few years because they were repeating a lot the same things. So I gave up with my visitation of churches. I started to look for a real laboratory of analogies, and that's how I found the perfect place, this jazz club. I'm lost in abstraction, doomed. I don't know which is the real simulation of the reality among all of those I'm sharing in my head. The jazz club is a virtual abstraction laboratory, I guess. Well, I'm not sure. The dance floor is the brain containing our universe. The cells are the particles. The springs between their two nucleus are strings swinging, spinning, rotating and bouncing in all directions. The music irradiating them is a field of quantums of action, bosons from other dimensions, the eternal speech of God. Hopefully my wife is there. I don't even know if all of this was part of a dream or my real life. Do I actually care? I don't think so. She's there, singing for all of us, and that's enough. She's the only one that can save me from these abstraction overdoses. Is she an operator, a function, an algorithm I create to regulate my frenzy? Is she an hypothesis, like everything else? Hypotheses fighting together for their own survival. I got reason, I got music, I got my woman. Who can ask for anything more?
Thank you.